Good afternoon, everybody. This is Dr. Gershon and Dr. Hazeltine today. We're here to talk about COVID as part of the Better Health webinar series on healthcare and innovation. I am delighted to have Dr. Hazeltine here today. And first, I want to thank our collaboration partners, McGill, Endeavor Life Sciences, and Capgemini for incredible contributions to the series. It's been a month of incredible discussions with some fascinating people. And I know I've received feedback from quite a number of attendees. It's been over 2,000 people that have visited the webinars and more to come. Over the next several months, we will be breaking down the webinars in four buckets. We will be talking about healthcare innovation in every one, but we will break down into four specific sectors. First, we're going to be talking about unicorns. Second, we're going to be talking about emerging healthcare and life science companies and bioag companies. Third, we're going to be talking about diversity and inclusion and recognizing the incredible contributions of women and minority CEO entrepreneurs and founders. And fourth, we're going to leave it as an open bucket for just a grab bag of amazing innovation and macro discussions. I'd like to take the opportunity now to introduce you to Dr. Hazeltine, who is listed by Time Magazine as one of the world's most 25 most influential business people, and by Scientific American as one of the 100 most influential leaders in biotechnology. He's the father of the Human Genome Project and several companies, including Human Genome Sciences, Dendreon, and Cambridge Biosciences. He has been on the Harvard Faculty of Medicine, and he's a prominent author of Omicron, From Pandemic to Endemic and Variants, Natural Immunity, COVID-19. Dr. Hazeltine will discuss how groundbreaking innovation and technology will address the next COVID outbreak with novel new vaccines currently in development and some of the problems that we as communities should be aware of in what seems to be a never-ending pursuit for vaccine development to ward off the next pandemic. Dr. Hazeltine, welcome. Thank you so much for being here. First, I would like to start off with a big picture. Where do you see the world right now in terms of its understanding of the pandemic? And what is the overall big picture view that governments and communities are taking towards the COVID virus right now?
Well, thank you, Martin. Thank you not just for this opportunity to speak today, but also for all the great work you're doing to help bring an understanding of the science of health, the needs, the people, the technologies, where we are and where we can be. And I'm very happy to be part of this discussion. You've asked me about COVID. We've all experienced COVID one way or another, all of us on this planet. Most of us have been infected at least once, not all, but I would say 80%, which is about 7 billion people have been infected. We've had many, many people die, over 1 million people just in the United States alone. And I don't think we really know the toll. It's been a real impact. It's impacted our economies. It's impacted the way we think about our own lives. It's had a fundamental reevaluation of our relationship to the natural world. We are not above it. We're part of it. And this is a reminder that we are part of it and we have to be aware, not that we're superior to any other being, but we are part of an integrated web, both on in terms of health, but even more than that, in terms of our environment, our atmosphere, our oceans, that we're intimately involved in that. And I think that's the biggest picture of what COVID has done. It's increased our awareness of our vulnerabilities, but also our intimate relationship to the world around us. And therefore, it expands our idea of what our vulnerabilities are and what our responsibilities are to make sure that we're the best custodians of our world, our planet, our environment, and of our health. It's also pointed out something about our world that we knew, but we often like to shove aside. And that's not, it's that we're not all equal in our access, not our access to opportunity, access to health in particular. As you know, I'm the founder and chair of Access Health International, which works on these issues of access to high quality, affordable care for all. And COVID has pointed out, perhaps as sharply as anything can, that there are gross inequities. Both we saw that in vaccine distribution. We saw that in our own country, in the United States, where some populations had several times the burden of disease and unfortunately even death that other populations had. Those are the populations that generally don't have access to high quality medical care. We also realize that no matter how good the quality of medical care you have, that there are still vulnerabilities. And I've had a number of my friends who have become very sick, and unfortunately some have died of this disease. So this has changed our relationship to ourselves, our country, our nations, our planets. It's been a major impact.
I completely agree. You know, the recognition that health and health and wellness is really the highest priority has been the only silver lining out of the COVID pandemic. That awareness, I think, has intersected with a number of business opportunities. And so I think one of the bright lights that we can shine on this is the response from large technology such as Microsoft, Google, Amazon, and Apple, NVIDIA, and other large pharmaceutical and biotech and medtech companies really stepping up to address the incredible advances in science and medicine and put money to work to bring better health across the board. And what I would love to talk a little bit more about is this intersection now, where you see the next involvement of the large pharma biotech companies in addressing some of these problems. It appears that there is certainly a level of acceptance throughout the world and perhaps even a level of complacency. And so I would like to better understand your perspective of what do you see as the next series of steps in preparedness for what obviously will be another pandemic at some point?
Well, thanks for that. And let me say, first of all, let's try to understand where we are with COVID. And I think that will be the basis for addressing your questions very directly. We'd like to think it's in the rearview mirror, that we've gone through the worst of it. And I hope that's true, but it is still with us. And I think what we can expect is that COVID will be like flu. It's going to come around again and again and again. We know that other members of this virus family, coronaviruses, do just that. Now, fortunately, they just give us colds. But you can get the same cold, pretty much the same cold from the same virus, year after year after year. We know we get colds year after year, and you may not be aware of it, but about a third of those colds are from coronaviruses. So it's their habit. They've evolved to infect healthy adults that have been recently infected. Flu does the same thing. And we're very familiar with the fact that if you haven't gotten your recent flu vaccine, you're probably not going to be protected from the next flu. And even then, you only have a 20 to 40%, 50% at most protection from the next flu that comes around. COVID is in that group of viruses that come around again and again. We've seen that happen. Contrary to what flu has done, that only usually comes in the winter, COVID has been coming in the winter, spring, summer, and fall. So we don't know if it's going to settle down. But the first thing is, it's not gone. Second thing, the good news is people have been infected people who have been vaccinated multiple times are unlikely to experience the most serious form of the disease, which is hospitalization and death. We're pretty much protected. We don't know for how long. With flu, we know we're not protected for very long, because I can say in my own life, I've had flu, serious flu, about five times. So it's not protecting me forever. And I expect that it will be the same with COVID. You can't expect the vaccines or natural infection to protect us forever. So what can we do? Well, another good thing that you have mentioned is that we've learned that we have a powerful scientific biomedical company group, when supported by government, can really work miracles. The rapid tests that we finally got are terrific. The vaccines that have been rolled out around the world, and billions of people have had them, are a technological marvel achieved in really record time. It's been just a fantastic experience of collaboration of fundamental science, biotech companies, large pharma. And another lesson most people don't, I think, really put in the right perspective is governments. The reason we were able to get these vaccines out so fast is government said, you make it and we'll pay for it. In fact, we'll even help you get there. And they put billions of dollars up front. That's a lesson. You know, years ago, I worked with an economist named Kramer, Michael Kramer. And he always said, if we're going to have vaccines, and you want vaccines for diseases you're not sure are going to come around, make a guarantee that if you develop it and you need it, you'll get paid for it. Well, we saw that work in spades. So the combination of government, big companies, biotech, fundamental science has really paid off. Now, what can we expect from this group going forward? Well, it's hard to say, because we've been places like this before, where we've had serious events and then we forget about them. And when we forget about them, we don't protect ourselves the way we should. We know certain things about COVID that are upsetting. One, it comes back. Two, our vaccines may protect us a little bit from infection at first. Then that protection fades. They protect us from disease. We don't know for how long. We need something else. And what I think that something else is, we as a biomedical community can provide. And that is a series of prophylactic drugs. There are diseases for which we have no vaccines, which we can eliminate. Let me mention, first of all, HIV/AIDS, which I worked on for many years. We don't have a vaccine. We may never have a vaccine. But certain countries, using combinations of drugs, have eliminated it altogether, and we have controlled it very well in the United States. Hepatitis C is another disease. We have drugs that, if you have it, you can eliminate it, not only from individuals, but from entire populations. That's been done in a few countries. Unfortunately, we haven't done it in our own country. We could, but we haven't yet. So drugs against the virus, this works specifically against the virus, can have a public health impact at not only preventing, treating, but eliminating disease. I've called for, and certain other people have called for, a massive effort, greater even than the effort that we use to create the vaccines, to create these antiviral drugs. Now, that will take a combination of fundamental science, biotech companies, pharmaceutical companies, and government providing the right incentives. For a while, we can do this. It's well within our scope. When I laid out 35 years ago a program to eliminate and control HIV/AIDS without a vaccine, people thought I was crazy. We now know it can be done. We did it. And we can accelerate it and do it even more quickly today with the powerful technologies we have. Things like AI-assisted, artificial intelligence-assisted drug development, which allow things to go much faster. We have tools we just almost could never dream about. We need the incentives, the integration, the planning on a global level, not just in our country, in other countries too. We can do this. I foresee a time when we can eliminate the threat of COVID and the threat of flu and other diseases through the use of drugs, even if vaccines will never do the job themselves.
Now, that's a great overview. We have also some terrific questions, which I would like to kind of put on the table right now for an open discussion. One of the questions relates to AI and the integration of AI into addressing healthcare in general, and some of the things that AI might be constrained by in terms of the ethics surrounding AI, which is, you know, really an interesting topic. You talked about access. That's again, kind of an important integration of the ethical boundaries. I know that you and Dr. Sandro Galeo at Boston University School of Public Health have extensive engagements regarding the public health, the ethical issues surrounding access to care. And I think I'd like to talk about these two particular points. One is the ethics surrounding AI, and two is the ethics surrounding access.
Well, those are both big, big topics. Let me say, first of all, when I was discussing AI, I don't think there's the type I was discussing, using it as an extra tool to accelerate drug discovery. There are many ethical issues. It's just another tool that we could use, a very powerful tool that can accelerate drug discovery, not only for COVID, but for many other diseases as well. I'm really excited about it. It can also be used for COVID in a number of different ways. But you've extended it to talk about AI for health systems. And there is a real discussion about how it interfaces with what happens in the doctor's office. Let me give you one example. There are programs being developed, some of them are developed, where essentially AI will listen in on the conversation between a doctor and the patient. We'll then give the doctor feedback about that conversation. We'll actually write the interview up for the doctor, which can be edited by the doctor. And that exists today and helps the chart, helps and is available to the patient as well. Now, that's at an interface, probably one of the most intimate interfaces we have. What we're doing, what we tell our doctor, what the doctor tells us. It can help. And it can help the doctor, rather than continuing to type in and look at his computer the other way, look at you, listen to you in a way that improves the conversation and the relationship between the doctor and the patient. Because right now, the way a lot of the computer programs work, they interfere with it. That's one use of it. It, of course, has a potential of stepping over the boundaries, the personal boundaries, and we've got to be very careful about how that information is managed. On the other extreme, AI is now being used to help people. Now, they're certainly conceivable. You can go on and say, I have these symptoms. I've taken my temperature. I even have a pulse oximeter. I have a blood pressure monitor. I have my Apple Watch, which is telling me all these different health indications. What's wrong with me, AI? Now, is that going to work? Well, it will help. But a good response, if things look like they're out of whack, is call your doctor. Or in the worst case, call 911 and get an ambulance out there right away. I think that's going to help. Are there ethical issues? Yes. Is this really replacing the experience of a doctor? Let's take another example. Go onto a health line and say, I'm feeling suicidal. What should I do? Do you need a person or can AI handle that? Doubtful, at least at its current stage, AI can handle those delicate conversations that a person, an experienced person would do. But at least it might help you get to a person. So there are lots of ways we can use AI for public health. Also, we could just look at the trends. One of the things we had, especially at the beginning of the COVID pandemic, is we were flying blind. We really didn't know how many people had it, where they had it. There are a lot of things AI could do to help that, to really help public health. So that's one area, I think, where AI is going to make a big difference to public health. It can be a big help. It will be, and it's already turning out to be a big help, but it's not all of the answers. Now, the other question you asked me is equity. Mm-hmm. Equity is really hard, even in our country. We know we're not equitable in our health. Let me just give you some statistics that underline that. We used to be, in the 50s, amongst the top five in the world on health outcomes. What's health outcomes? Really important things. How long we live. Maternal health and how many women die in childbirth. How many babies die before the age of one? How many die before the age of five? What's the death rate in teenagers? Well, when you add all that up, you get a sort of a relative number. And we have, since the 50s, steadily gone down. The fact we're now about 35th in the world, way out of bounds for in terms of overall healthcare. We're slightly above the Dominican Republic, which isn't a good place to be. Yet we spend twice as much as any other country on healthcare. How can that be? Now, you and I have access to wonderful healthcare. We live in New York. We know a lot of doctors. The difference between knowing you or me and getting a 6 month or a 6 hour appointment with a doctor, we can see a doctor the next day. Most people, it takes months. And even then, you don't have the best healthcare. The reason we have such bad statistics isn't that we don't have some of the best hospitals in the world, some of the best doctors in the world. It's that most people don't. Most people don't. And we saw that, COVID. We saw the death rates in people who are socially and economically disadvantaged was horrendously high. Five, in some cases, eight times higher than in other populations. So if we're going to, and what's important about that, both in the global sense and the national sense, as long, especially with infectious diseases, some people in the country are infected, they're going to spread that disease to everybody. Because who were a lot of those people? The very people who deliver your food, the people who serve you in shops, the people who transport you from one place to another, they have to work regardless of the raging pandemic. And they have to be protected, but they're often in economically disadvantaged. So, yes, it's an ethical issue, and it's also a common sense issue. To protect yourself, you've got to protect others, especially with infectious diseases. So I hope that addresses at least
some of
the questions. And let me just say one other thing. We live in a world that's so globally connected. Think of this. 5 billion people are on a plane a year. There are 5 billion individual plane trips. Many of those are international. What happens in country A is pretty good as soon happen in country B. We watched that in real time. We saw a new variant appear in South Africa, and before we could blink our eyes, it was here in New York, and before the next time we blinked our eyes, it was the major strain all over the world. That happened time and time again during the pandemic and will happen again. So we are connected. So what happens there is important here.
Well, what you're saying is resonating quite strongly with our audience, because we've got a number of different people commenting, and I want to thank those people and encourage more to put comments into the chat. I want to thank Samar and Michael and Tina and anybody else. Please chime in. Let us know where you're dialing in from, and some of your thoughts and comments on this, you know, really amazing discussion, which covers science, ethics, public health. So thank you, everybody who is attending, for your thoughts, and please keep them coming. I'd like to shift a little bit now into some of the more scientific aspects. And you are a prominent scientist. You have spent your whole life in a science, and now is really, I think, for me personally, I'd like to hear your thoughts, an incredible experience, because the integration of science, medicine, and investment really is taking things to the next level. So you talked about electronic healthcare records. I want to point out that Microsoft has played an incredible lead in this by its acquisition of Nuance and the integration of voice-activated electronic healthcare records is going to become mainstream. And I do think that that will help using big data analysis to help on the public health side. I also think that the integration of big tech into core scientific discoveries has led to some amazing advances in areas like hydrogels. And so when you talk about preventative measures, the inhalation of a substance to coat the lungs as a preventative is something that we're beginning to explore. I would love to hear any of your thoughts on some of these actions about the integration of some of the large biotech companies, some of the large pharma companies, and some of the big tech companies as they address some of these public health concerns.
Well, this is truly an age of marvels. You've mentioned I've been in scientific research and following it pretty closely for the last 50 years or more. And I can tell you at the outset, I was a student of the great James D. Watson, who is one of the discoverers of DNA, and was there when he was writing the book, The Molecular Biology of the Gene, which laid out the basically fundamentals of how life works, which has really been a driving engine. I've been there through the AIDS crisis, through the beginnings and elaboration of the human genome effort. And what we've seen is science proceeds through the discovery of new tools. But those tools aren't necessarily developed for the purpose of science. For example, take the whole computer revolution. That we've seen makes our life much easier. It controls our automobiles and planes and many other things. But it turns out it's been critical for understanding life and creating new ways to improve our lives. For example, when I was creating the human genome sciences, we combined three technologies, which probably were maybe 6 months from the time they could have been developed. One was automated DNA sequencing at scale. Two was robotics. And three was the information technology that allowed you to handle that amount of information that we could produce millions of times greater than we'd ever done before in biology and make sense out of it. Well, that has continued. Advances in material sciences that underlie hydrogels, for example, or advances in computation that allows you to scan through a trillion theoretical structures and match it to a particular protein structure at an atomic level. So you know within a tenth of an angstrom, the one-tenth of the size of an atom, how pieces are going to fit together. Think of it as solving the world's most gigantic puzzle, three-dimensional puzzle. Well, that's what these computers can do for artificial intelligence-assisted drug design. Or think of handling the massive amount of data that comes out of AI and these health records, where you can actually begin to correlate genome sequence to life history. Those are things that we can do now that we could never do before. And those are tremendous advances. But to bring them down to a practical level, you know, one thing that's really important for science is not just to have an idea, but to have an idea of how that can be used. And even more important than that, something I try to tell people that are interested in technology, a successful business is one that meets a perceived human need. That's an important concept. You have to know what human perceived needs are. Now, perceived needs doesn't just mean a need for food or shelter. It's something that we really want. And a business that can provide that need, an answer to that need, as something for that need, is really important. So you have to understand the kinds of things we're talking about, the structure of the world today, how we're interrelated, what people experience, what our needs are. You find a solution to that need, and you have the beginnings of a good business. It's almost like how you make a scientific advance. Some of the questions that we ask are been asked forever. How do we inherit? How do we see? How do we smell? How come we age? What is the origin of life? Is there a meaning of life? These are all questions. How, as a scientist, you find a way to address those questions? Well, it takes sort of a fine feel for what the questions are that are important for people, what the technologies that exist are, and how current technologies and tools that you have at your disposal can answer that question. Let me give you an example that came up recently. Somebody recently looked at Leonardo da Vinci's notebooks again. What did they find? That he was really interested in gravity. And he did experiments to figure out, is there a gravitational constant, sort of what Newton discovered? Yet he understood it, he almost got it right. But at the time he was working, he didn't have the tools he needed. What tools did he need? A clock, a watch. How to determine time precisely. Once you had that, you could answer the question. So Newton did it, and we know the results. But he did it because he could measure time precisely. And Leonardo had the right ideas, but he couldn't measure it precisely enough, so he didn't get quite the right answer. That's what you do as a scientist, and that's what you have to do as a businessman too. Great technologies out there. Many, many possibilities. Which ones meet the most pressing human needs are going to be the ones that make successful businesses. And we need the businesses to translate those advances into human use. You know, I come from a background of scientists, that my grandfather was an MIT graduate. My father was an MIT graduate and a PhD in physics. But especially my dad in the environment I grew up in, developing weapons, wasn't really quite the human need. And it took me a while as a scientist to recognize that it was businesses that turn ideas into products for people's use. It took me a while. Once I realized that, I moved into business. I started starting companies. I've started maybe 12 companies that have brought 6 drugs to market today. But it's the businesses that do that. And it's the big businesses that actually spread it around the world. Either little businesses become big businesses or big businesses take the ideas from little companies and spread it. So it's a wonderful mix of intellectual exercise and also, I would say, input from understanding humanity that comes from science, but beyond science. Because science isn't about understanding humans. It's about understanding the natural world. Understanding our fellow humans comes from the humanities. And I think that's also really important for scientists to appreciate. Yes, you can make a contribution, but if you're going to make a difference to human life, you better understand human life pretty well.
No, you're making incredible points. It's the humanism, really, that's important in understanding how we advance society. One of the things I do want to point out is the role that large pharma is now playing is somewhat, you know, unique in our history. They are collaborating now with each other in unprecedented ways to address some of these human problems. And exactly as you point out, try to define what are the needs and what are the tools that we need to answer these problems. One incredible accelerator that I want to highlight, which is an accelerator that I am somewhat involved with, is an organization called Future for Care. Now, this is an organization that is a collaboration of Sanofi, Capgemini, Orange, and Generali. Very unlikely partners. However, they have made 80 investments over the past year in the digital health space to address many of the issues that you're talking about. They're looking at ways to improve access to care through digitalization. They're looking at ways to improve the understanding of treatment algorithms. And yes, they're looking at ways to address next generation pandemics. My fascination with this digitalization of health, I think, really goes to the core of what you're talking about, which is the ability to understand, you know, the tools that we have and how to address the needs to solve healthcare problems. One company that I do want to highlight, you know, in this discussion is a company that is really cutting edge and next generation. And it is a company called Metaloop. This company really is addressing amazing AI technology. It's run by actually a doctor from McGill and from Montreal, Dr. Rene Cassie. He is, I think, a pioneer, really, is not too strong a word, in looking at the integration of AI and multiple different parameters. So his company is, I think, using technologies now to integrate with Apple, with Google, and other players to bring together genetic information, electronic healthcare record information, the ability to analyze multiple companies who have hardware that monitor biometrics. He's looking at integrating all of these things into a cloud-based program and looking at treatment algorithms, propensity for diseases, the ability to understand compliance, and yes, even the ability to look at big data across the world and analyze public health trends. So I think one of the things that's embedded in these series of Better Health is people who are taking the lead on using technologies, exactly what you said, using the tools at our disposal to solve problems. And a company like Metaloop really stands out in that charge against pandemics, against diseases in general, and I think speaks to the collaboration that industry and pharma are bringing to bear. One of the things that's exciting about this collaboration is it brings people from all different sectors and focuses them in a team effort to solve problems. And it's that leadership, that dedication to improving the health and wellness for everybody that is really exciting to me. So I would like to shift a little bit now into what you see as next steps. What can people expect in the next evolution of healthcare, and particularly the next generation of vaccines and the next generation of awareness and problem solving as it pertains to COVID?
Well, let me address that, but let me begin by addressing some of the issues that you just mentioned. Those are certainly very high aspirations. And one of the great things about data is once you can integrate it, it really makes a difference. So congratulations to your colleagues in McGill that are, seem to be at the forefront of data integration. It's going to be increasingly important as we have many different systems putting data in different formats. There have to be ways to integrate it across different spheres. And as we get to a more global perspective, it's even more important. We at Access Health right now are working very closely with the Indian government to create a unique health record across 160,000 different clinics in all of India that are currently being created. This program called Ayushman Bharat. And we've been helping to conceptualize that and now implement that for 500-600 million people. And I think that's the kind of thing that not only should we do there, but that kind of information can hopefully be integrated on a more global level. I'd also say that there's also positives and negatives. It's true that the big pharma companies are working together and are making some of their most powerful medicines available. But we know that the cost of medicines is really a barrier in many countries. And it's not just the cost of the medicine. It's having the infrastructure to deliver that medicine, even if the cost is acceptable and low. So I think there are ethical issues that are being worked out. We can see that many of the companies that are developing or have developed effective drugs for COVID have made those available at low cost. Yet we are all familiar with the inequities in vaccine distribution, not just because the companies are charging for it or the governments are not making it available, because there's just not the infrastructure there or the structures in the company, in the countries, to be able to administer those vaccines. So there's a lot of work we still have to do. I think the good thing about many of the programs you discussed is that they're on the agenda and we know where we have to go. Where are we going in the future? Well, that is a very interesting topic. I'm actually just embarking now on a series of books I've wanted to write for a long time on a field I called regenerative medicine. I actually coined that term back in 1999. That seems like a long time, almost 25 years ago, to describe for a group of senior policymakers in Europe. They were then getting together to structure the euro to talk about the future of health. I tried to think about gene therapy or stem cells or tissue engineering. And I realized those were terms that were going to be kind of harsh to their ear and their sentiment. So I came up with the term regenerative medicine because it's something everybody understands. We want to be put back into the health we were before something happened, before we had an injury, before we got a disease, and I guess say before we started getting old. We want to be in the best health we can be. Maybe not live forever, but at least live healthily as long as we're alive. And there are now a series of technologies which I see coming together. But some of them are very simple technologies, like exercise machines or things that can stimulate your body to be healthier. But some of them are more complicated. First of all, drugs. We're now getting to the point where many of the diseases, for example, mental diseases or diseases of neurodegeneration, maybe chemical drugs can help. Then there are, of course, protein drugs, which is the biotech revolution. They've done wonders for us. Erythropoietin to let our red blood cells grow, for example, or GM-CSF to make our white cells fight more effectively. Then, of course, there's gene replacement or gene alteration. I call that leveling the genetic playing field so that all of us, no matter what genes we're born with, can basically expect a normal, healthy lifespan. Now, we've had a huge assist in that with the new technologies generally called CRISPR that are much more efficient, much more specific in changing our genes. And that is happening now for people who have, for example, there's a gene that predisposes people to Alzheimer's called APOE4. Well, there's now experiments that suggest, at least in animal models of that human disease, if you knock out that particular gene, you knock out the predisposition to Alzheimer's. Well, that is something on the table, which we may see in the next few years. So altering our genes for better health, sickle cell disease and other diseases, are really on the table. And then, of course, there's the use of our own cells as medicine. We know that for blood transfusions, platelet transfusions, but now we're getting to the point, we know that for bone marrow transplants, for example. Now we're getting to the point where you may be able to insert retinal cells, for example, so to restore vision. You may be, and we're getting hopefully to the point where we can both knock out the immune response to our islet cells that produce insulin and find ways to implant insulin-producing cells to cure type 1 diabetes. We're on the brink of a really amazing new kind of medicine. If that weren't enough, we're opening whole new realms in the field of what I call bioprostheses. Surely you can see I'm wearing glasses. That's a prosthetic. If I hurt my back, I'm going to be using a cane. That's a prosthetic. But we're now getting to the point where we can actually substitute major deficiencies. If you have spinal cord severance, we're getting to the point where you may be able to control machines that let you walk, let you read, let you use computers, even if you have a serious spinal cord injury. We're doing that with reading your brain waves rather than inserting chips into your brain. And these are man-machine interfaces that are going to make a big difference to our future. So this whole idea that we're end-oriented, not technique-oriented, I think is the major point. Use whatever technique science and technology allows to restore us to normal health. And this is not going to take one book. This is going to take a series of a lot of books just to summarize what's going on now and what the potentials are. It's an amazing time for science. And of course, we've mentioned the science will be there, but the translation to human use is going to require generations of new companies, big companies working with the smaller companies, people who are interested in biology working with computer scientists, them working with sociologists and public health officials. It's a wonderful time for technologies and for synergies.
Well, first, I can't thank you enough for these incredible insights, your experience, your subject matter expertise, your hands-on operational experience in building companies, and your contribution to healthcare in developing countries is just phenomenal. I can see here that we have a load of comments, which I'm going to forward off to you, and hopefully we can get you to get involved with feeding answers back to many of our people. I want to thank everybody for attending yet another amazing webinar with Dr. Hazeltine. Next week, please register again. We're going to have a fantastic webinar on Tuesday of next week at noon as part of our series. It will be the fifth in the series, a very exciting interaction about what's happening in early stage emerging healthcare companies. I will leave you with one last thought here. I believe that over the next several years, many of the issues that Dr. Hazeltine has talked about, the integration of many of these tools, will be front and center in our lives, will be impacting our health and wellness. And so the integration of genetics, regenerative medicine, restorative medicine, preventative medicine, are all going to be part of our normal activities. We will wake up in the morning. We will have our iPhone next to us. We will look at the data that has come across from our AI program in the evening, and we will see the condition of each organ, our overall metabolic state, and our immune state. And we will then have our cup of coffee and get ready for the day. So I'm excited about the future. I am heavily involved in sponsoring and engaging with early stage companies. I know that McGill and Capgemini are tremendous supporters of what Endeavor is doing, both in our life science unit and in our fund. And I want to thank everybody for their participation with their thoughtful comments. And Dr. Hazeltine, I can't wait for our next discussion. Thank you so much. And thank you very much for our audience. Have a wonderful afternoon.
Thank you, Martin. Bye.